Good morning, my brothers and sisters. We are back in the house this morning for our virtual services. And I would just like to say to everybody, I hope that you are doing well, that we serve an awesome God, and we would like to thank God for bringing us up to this point and for watching us during this pandemic. But we're going to go ahead and get services started, and I would like to say a prayer now. So may we all bow. O gracious Heavenly Father, dear Lord, we come this morning with thanksgiving on our lips. Dear Lord, thanking you for bringing us to this point. Thanking you for watching over us, dear Father. Thanking you, dear Lord, for taking care of our every need. Now, dear Master, we pray for those who are in need this morning. We pray for those who are less fortunate than we are, dear Father. We pray for the sick and the sick. We pray for our brothers and sisters who may be going through bereavement at this very moment. Dear Lord, we pray and ask that you would extend your loving arms from heaven, dear Father, and that you would place them around us, dear Lord, that you may comfort us during these times. Dear Father, bless those who are going through a storm right now and allow them to know, dear Father, that you are with them as they go through the storm, dear Father. Dear Lord, we are just a grateful people, grateful for all the things that you have done for us, dear Father. In the past, the things that you are doing now, dear Lord, and all the things that you have promised to do for us in the future, dear Lord. We just thank you, and I pray this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, who is Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Amen, my brothers and sisters. This morning, text will come from the Old Testament, the book of Nehemiah, the 4th chapter, verses 1 through 6. And when you find it, please say amen. And it reads, chapter 4, Nehemiah chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. And it reads, but it came to pass that when Sanballat heard that we builded the wall, he was wroth and took great indignation and mocked the Jews. And he spoke before the brethren and the army of Samaria and said, what do these feeble Jews? Will they fortify themselves? Will they sacrifice? Will they make an end in a day? Will they receive the stones out of the heaps of the rubbish which are burned? Now Tobiah the Ammonite was by him, and he said, even that which they built, if a fox go up, he shall even break down their stone. Hear, O God, for we are despised, and turn their reproach upon their own head, and give them for a prey in the land of captivity. And cover not their iniquity, and let not their sin be blotted out from before thee, for they have provoked thee to anger before the builders. So built we the wall, and all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof. For the people had a mind to work. May the Lord have a blessing to the readers, the hearers, but especially the doers of his holy word. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
sharing with us on today, or opening on today with our scripture and prayer. And I thank you for attending our virtual worship service today. From the passage of scripture that he read earlier, as recorded in the book of Nehemiah, chapter 4, verses 1 through 6, I'd like to use for theme or subject today a work in progress.
All right.
A work in progress. And I would pray, my brothers and sisters, that you would read the scripture of the text in its entirety before you retire on today. Today I want to pause, salute, and recognize all of the NBA, the WNBA, Major League Baseball, and all professional sports associations who took a stance and voiced their outrage regarding the latest victim of police brutality, Brother Jacob Blake. These players used their platform and their power to ignite protests. Yes, America needed to be reminded that Black lives still matter. From Trayvon Martin to Breonna Taylor to George Floyd and now Jacob Blake, Black lives still matter. And yes, my brothers and sisters, when we review things, I believe that we've made some tremendous strides and progress via the civil rights movement led by such prominent figures as Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Malcolm X, and others who made a way and paved the way for the Barack Obamas and the Kamala Harrises of the world. But it is still painfully obvious that there is still work to be done. I do believe, as you all know, I do believe in the separation of church and state. But I want you to know, without the church, the state that we're in now would be even worse. In essence, never have I used the pulpit as a political platform, but I want us to recognize that the issue here is not solely one of politics. This is not a political issue. It is a people issue. It's not solely one of ethnicity, but rather one of equality. And it's not about a particular race, it's about the human race. That there are those that have misconceived and misconstrued our message that when we say Black lives matter, that we don't mean that all lives matter. In fact, I've had discussions with some of my Caucasian brethren and sisters, and in those discussions, they will always say to me that not only do Black lives matter, all lives matter. And I totally agree with that statement, but I don't want them to lose or take the phrase out of context. When we chant Black lives matter, we're simply saying Black lives matter as well as white lives, as well as Hispanic lives, as well as Jewish lives. All human lives matter because we are wonderfully and fearfully made, and we are created in the very image and likeness of God. Now, I want you to know that although we may be enraged as well as outraged, we must contain our composure, we must contain our dignity, and we must maintain our focus. In other words, we need to keep our mind on our mission and our mission on our mind. In essence, the people must have a mind to work. And my brothers and sisters, I believe that principle is paralleled within our text. Nehemiah records the last historical events of the Old Testament, carrying the history to about 430 BC. And the principal characters of the book are Ezra and Nehemiah. Some scholars even contend that Ezra and Nehemiah were originally one book. In fact, the Jewish Torah lists them as one book to date. But more than a book of history, more than chronicles and facts that paralleled the lives of the Jews, it is a book of encouragement, a book of importance, and a against all odds type of book. And I believe when we look at this story, it speaks to us today as African Americans and as a society as a whole with what we're currently dealing with at the hands of police brutality and social injustice. The first thing I see in the text is the problem detected, the problem detected. What has happened, my brothers and sisters, is that the nation of Israel has now been released from captivity. And Zerubbabel and Ezra have led the return of the Israelites back to Jerusalem. The temple has been rebuilt and the priesthood has been reestablished,
But even though the temple has been rebuilt, as recorded by the book of Ezra, the walls of the city still lie in ruin. And now it's Nehemiah's mission to rebuild the city walls. I hope that I'm preaching better than you're saying amen. And if you look at the text, you realize, as I mentioned, the civil rights movement, that through many dangers, toils, and snares, we have already come. But yet, I want us to realize that there is still far to go. If you look at society today, and we just check and call out some of the names that I've listed in this brief sermonic dissertation, you'll understand that we're still facing social injustice. We're still facing racial injustice. Where we're judging people by the content of their skin as opposed to their character. That yes, we've come a mighty long way, but we still have a long way to go. And it's up to us to have a mind to work. We have to have the same mindset that our forefathers and our mothers had back in their day when facing these obstacles. That it is our opportunity, and we can't squander this opportunity. Don't miss that. That when there is an obstacle, there's really just an opportunity if you're doing a work for God. Uh-huh. In other words, there's still work to do because there is no rest in progress. Let me set the tone if I can. That after the reign of Solomon, the kingdom was divided into northern, southern, and central Israel. And because the nation was divided, the division made the nation easier to conquer. In essence, we need to understand that united we stand and divided we fall. Uh-huh. When we are separated and segregated from each other, it causes us to be sitting targets for the enemies. That it causes us to fall easy prey to the enemy. Let me see if I can make that plain and bring it in today's context. That though it may not have been your brother or your sister that died at the hands of police brutality, it was somebody's brother and somebody's sister. And an injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. So just as you will be outraged if it touched you personally, you should be just as outraged because it touched your brother and your sister. I wish I had a Sam and Dave thing in here that said, when something is wrong with my baby, something is wrong with me. When somebody is oppressing my brother and my sister, they're also oppressing me. And it's my job and our responsibility to band together and unite in unity, because united we stand and divided we fall. The rebuilding of Jerusalem had direct impact on the future of Samaria. Let me see if I can make that plain. That one of the main highways linking the Tigris and Euphrates River valley to the north of Egypt and the south of Philistia and the west passes through Jerusalem. And because of this, Samaria took it as a personal threat. Let me bring you up to date with that. There are people, brothers and sisters, that are of different race and different ethnicities than African Americans, who seem to believe that our progress is a threat to their success. That just because we're asking for freedom and just because we're asking for our God-given rights doesn't threaten your God-given rights. What God has for you, it is for you. And what God has for me, it is for me. And the last time I checked, the Bible said that the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. That he gives to who he chooses to give to. And when he does it, he can do it exceedingly and abundantly above all you can ask or think. It's time to get rid of the mindset to think that my progress is a threat to your success. Jerusalem was once a well-protected city. Its very location would attract trade and increase not only the prosperity of Jerusalem, but it would also increase prosperity in Samaria. That it would also help the economy in Samaria. See, my white brothers and sisters have to understand that once we link together and once we come together, it's not just for the embetterment of the African-American race, it's for the embetterment of the human race. Let me see if I can make that plain, that there are those, once again, that think that your progress affects their success. But what you have to understand, if I'm successful and you're successful, then we're all successful and we're successful together. You know what I'm talking about, kids, our young folk today, call them player haters. They don't want to see you prosper because they think that it affects their prosperity. But once, my brothers and sisters, once you see the text, you see that the problem is detected. The next thing I see is the plan developed. The Nehemiah, when you read the previous chapter, verse 4, it says that it came to pass that when I heard these words, I sat down and wept, and I mourned certain days, fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. So Nehemiah developed this plan, but guess what his plan is? His plan is to mourn, fast, and pray. To mourn, fast, and pray. He mourns the condition, then he begins to fast or sacrifice, and then he prays before the God of heaven. See, we need to take that note today that before we move, we got to make sure we're not moving in the wrong direction and make sure we're not moving in a senseless direction. And the only way we can accomplish that is through prayer, because a righteous man's steps are ordered by the Lord. That before we move, as far as the movement is concerned, we need to make sure that every move we make is a move that has been saturated and approved by prayer. I wish I had some domino players in here this morning. You know, when you get to a certain point in a domino game, I like to talk noise when I play, and I tell them, you better make your next move your best move, because I'm about to rock out. See, before we take another move, we need to make sure that we spend some time in prayer and that God is guiding us and leading us. Because I want you to know this morning that the will of God will never take you where the will of God will not protect you.
All right.
Bible says that men ought to always pray. That we ought to pray without ceasing. See, it's important, my brothers and sisters, that we pray, because the enemy is very crafty and the enemy is very cunning. And in the middle of our mission, the enemy can cause us to doubt or think that God has abandoned us. That's why it's imperative and important that we keep a prayer life and keep the lines of communication open with the Father, making sure that the steps that we are taking are steps that are ordered by Him. Once again, I said that the enemy is very crafty and the enemy is very cunning. Somebody knows what I'm talking about. When I say crafty and cunning, an example of that is they traded in a white sheet for a black robe. Right. Because there's more of our African-American brothers in prison. Good God,
come on, Pastor.
All right.
Than there is functioning in society. So he develops this plan by praying. And because he prays, when he goes to the king, Artaxerxes, when he goes to the king, God allows him to find favor with the king, and the king gives him not only permission, but the right of safer passage, as well as provisions. So he gives him permission and provisions for the mission. See, when you're moving in the steps in which God ordered you to move, God will allow you to find favor in man. But there'll be folk that bless you that don't even like you. There'll be folk that bless you that don't even know why they're blessing you. But our God has the ability to lay it on their heart and place it on their heart, because he's just that type of God. But then you see, my brothers and sisters, after the plan is developed, we have the persecution dispersed. That anytime someone sets out to accomplish a work of God, there will always be those to stand in opposition of the work.
Come on, Pastor.
That Sanballat hears what Nehemiah has done. And what he does is he begins to mock the Jews, that he's become angry, and he mocks them and makes fun of them before the army. He basically says that they're building the wall is a futile effort, that it won't come to pass. Matter of fact, what type of materials will they use? Will they use the rubbish and the stones that are already burned? He uses means of criticism and mockery to discourage the Jews. And see, my brothers and sisters, we have to be mindful of that and know that the enemy will criticize us and the enemy will mock us, but it's designed to discourage us from doing the work that God has placed for us to do. He says, will they make an end of day? In other words, that means will they build a wall by the end of the day? He refers to the ideas that the Jews not only working during the day, but they'll be unsuccessful in completing their tasks. And then watch this, haters link up with haters. Because not only is Sanballat making a mockery of the Jews, he's joined by Tobiah. And both of them start mocking and opposing the work of the Jews. And they criticize the quality of the work, saying that if you do build the wall, that a fox will come on the wall and be able to break the wall down. Yeah. See, there are those that when we all are moving in the direction that God has taught us to move in, and we started making progress, there are those that sit back and say that our work is futile. There are those that sit back and say that we won't be able to complete our tasks. And as a matter of fact, sometimes my brothers and sisters, it's the majority of people that say that. But what I've realized that when it comes to the majority and the minority, that I may be a minority, but with me and God, I'm no longer the minority. I am the majority. And what I like about having God on my side and me being on his side is I have home court advantage, because the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof and they that dwell within.
Come on.
There are those, my brothers and sisters, like I said, kids, call them player haters. That any time progress is being made, you'll find some opposition. But you got to learn to shake the haters off. I'm reminded in the book of Joshua that we need to remember that there cannot be a conquest without first encountering some conflict. That sometimes in effort for us to experience progress, we must encounter problems. But watch this, don't just think that there's outside opposition. Don't just think that it's Sanballat and Tobiah that's hating. Sometimes there's also some inside inquisition. You got outside opposition, but you also have inside inquisition. It means you got those that look like you, but don't have the same mentality that you have. Oh, I wish that you could help me this morning. In other words, back before the civil rights movement, when you go back to slavery, there were those of us that worked in the house, and there were those of us that worked in the field. And the ones that worked in the field always had a yearning to be free. But the ones that worked in the house said everything is fine. See, as long as it didn't affect them personally. Not only do we have outside opposition, but you have some inside inquisition. Those that look just like you, but won't even support the cause. I'm not going to call no names, Herman Cain, but those that look just like you, good God Almighty, that'll stand up. To me, it's not about being a Democrat. It's not about being Republican, independent, or bipartisan. If the person that's in the White House ain't making sense, frankly, just don't make sense. But what does Nehemiah do? What does Nehemiah do in this case? Nehemiah, look at his recourse and his resource. That opposition, not only, see, they meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. Because when it comes to God's people, we may be faced with some outside opposition and some inside inquisitions, but opposition always brings the people of God to their knees in prayer.
All right.
So what Nehemiah does is in response and in recourse, he begins to pray. And he prays in verse 4, hear, O God, hear us, O God. Mm-hmm. In other words, I love his prayer, because what he's basically saying is that when forces of evil surround us, mm-hmm. and when we are faced with adversity and disencouragement, This teaches us that we must turn to God. It's interesting to note, my brothers and sisters, that Nehemiah is driven to pray at least 8 times during these events. And guess what his prayer is? He prays, "Let my opposition know what it feels like to be oppressed."
He says,
"Lord, let my opposition know what it feels like to be oppressed." Uh-huh. In other words, I've heard it said that the ditch you dig for me might just be a ditch for you.
Uh-huh.
I've heard it said that when you dig in a ditch, you might need to dig two, one for me and one for you. See, because when it comes to ditch digging, if I use my spiritual imagination, when it comes to ditch digging, it makes me take my advice from Joseph, because Joseph knew some things about being in a ditch, that his own brothers sold him into slavery, and he was left in a ditch to die. But then when things have finally turned around, and Joseph could have been evil, Joseph just replied to them that you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. See, I had to go to the ditch. I had to go to the pit so it would escalate me to prison. I had to be in prison so it would escalate me to the palace. And I had to be in the palace so that I could be in a position of prominence. See, you might dig a ditch for me right now, but the ditch you dig, watch God bring me out of it. Oh, I'm reminded about that man that had a mule. He had a mule and he was going along, and his mule all of a sudden fell in a ditch. And he called his friends over, and they tried everything they could to try to get his mule out of the ditch. They tried to hoist it up with ropes. They tried to get a ladder and climb down. And they did all of their efforts seemed to be futile. So finally they took out a shovel and figured they would just bury the mule. So they took out the shovel and dug up some dirt and started pitching it in the pit over the mule. They took out some more dirt and pitched it in the pit over the mule. But every time that the dirt fell on the mule's back, the mule just shook it off and packed it under his feet. And the more dirt that they put in, and the more he shook it off and patted it under his feet, before you knew it, the mule had rised up out of the ditch. Oh, I wish I had a Maya Angelou fan that say, "You can do what you want to me right now, but because of the God that I serve, I want you to know that still I rise." You can shoot us in the back, but still we rise. You can handcuff us and leave us for dead, but still
I rise.
Say, I'm not worried about my enemies. Let the ditch diggers dig, but let the praise begin.
Yes.
Because David said, "Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies, and I anointed my head with oil, so my cup runneth over." See, you do understand that the God that we serve, he knows how to make waiters and waitresses out of your enemies.
Right.
And he says, "Thou anointest my head with oil till my cup runneth over." Not only does he bless me, but I got an overflow of blessings. And with that overflow of blessings, it's designed for me to bless somebody else. You do know that, don't you? That the best way to get a blessing is to be a blessing. I got to get out of here. I'm going to use the last point, and it's the thing that I want us to take on with us, that even though they faced opposition, and even though they faced persecution, the people were determined. The people were determined. Because verse 6 says, as the wall was beginning to join together, and a wall was beginning to form, when it got to about half the height, see, in other words, you don't miss that. The wall didn't start out at half the height. In other words, the wall lie in ruin. But they kept working through the opposition. They kept working through the inquisitions. They kept working through the hurling insults. They kept working through, even when it was being made a mockery of, they still kept on working. They were just like that mule. No matter how you talk about us, no matter what you say, I'm going to lay yet another brick. In other words, I want us to understand that if we keep laying bricks, then all of a sudden the wall was formed together. If we keep laying bricks of love, we'll see the wall rising up.
If we keep laying bricks of peace, we'll see the wall joining together. If we keep laying bricks of unity, we'll see the wall starting to form together. If we keep laying bricks of prosperity, we'll see the wall starting to form together. If we keep the mentality of lifting up my brother and realizing that he ain't heavy, we'll start to see the wall forming together. See, it started out as the wall laying in ruin, but as they got together and kept working through the trials and through the tribulation, through the mockery and through the discord, through all of the trials and tribulation, through all of the insults, good God Almighty, that were hurled at them, I know that they kept on working, because the Bible says that the people had a mind to work. And I just wonder, my brother and my sisters, is there anybody here that's got a made up mind that said, I got my mind on my mission and my mission on my mind? For the people had a mind to work. They begin to work together in the midst of adversity. They begin to work together with a unified purpose, compelling each man to have the desire to finish the work. Somebody don't understand what I'm saying. But see, if you understand the way the city of Jerusalem is built, said David said that Jerusalem is built as a city that is compact together. Whether the tribes go up or the tribes go down, until the testimony of the Lord. If you keep on reading, you'll find that we're not just talking about the one particular wall, but it was a wall within a wall, a wall composed of many walls. See, first you had the sheep gate, and the reason the sheep gate was important, because we have a Lamb of God who sacrificed his life for the sins of the world. And then they had the fish gate, and the reason the fish gate is important, because Jesus said that I will make you the fisher of men. And then you had what is called the old gate, and the reason the old gate was a present, because thus said the Lord, stand in the ways and ask for the old path where there is good in thy way. And then they had the valley gate, and a good part about the valley gate, it reminds me of David, that yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadows of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me, just thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies, thy anointing my head with oil, my cup running over, but I like the end part that surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. But then you have the dung gate, and what the dung gate did is it carried on of the filth away. Let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness in flesh and spirit, perfecting the holiness and the fear of God. But then you had the water gate, and the water gate symbolized that he is the living water. And after drinking this water, I shall not thirst anymore. But then you had the horse gate, and the horse gate, it symbolized war. Then ride on, King Jesus, ride on, King Jesus, no man shall not hinder me. But then you have the east gate. The reason the east gate is important, because the sun will rise in the east. There's somebody here that said he's my bright and morning star, my rose of Sharon, my lily of the valley. But then you have the milk pack gate, and that was formed. You registered when they came into the cities. Is there anybody here that knows what I'm talking about? That in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, when the last trump shall sound, I've been registered in the city of the kingdom. I've wrote my name on his roll. That he wrote my name on his roll. Is there anybody here that knows my Savior? I said the people had a mind to work. And as long as you're working, you just sit back and watch God work it out. Somebody don't know what I mean. That there was two sisters headed to the grave, and Jesus was in that grave, and they were wondering who was going to roll the stone away. But when they got there, they found out that the stone had already been rolled away. I said, the reason you should keep on working, because why are you trying to figure it out? I said, why are you trying to figure out? The Lord is already. He's already worked it out. Yeah. Ain't the Lord all right? I said, ain't the Lord all right? I know he's all right.
Well, the people had a mind to work. Let us be diligent and not be weary in well-doing. For this too shall pass. We shall continue to make progress. We shall overcome. We will not stop, and we will not rest until we no longer have to use the slogan, until it becomes automatically and equivocally known that black lives still matter and all lives matter. We take this opportunity and this privilege that if there's one here today or one under the sound of my voice, brother, that has not accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, we extend unto you this opportunity. All you have to do right where you are, just confess that you are a sinner, that you are in need of salvation, and confess that you accept him as your Lord and Savior, then you too shall be saved. You too shall partake of the goodness and the mercy of the Lord. If there's someone out there, why don't you pray that prayer right now? Lord, I am a sinner. I am in need of salvation. And I recognize that you provided the method of salvation, in that of sending your darling son, Jesus Christ, who sacrificed his life for my sins. And because I believe, and according to your word, then I am saved. There's one in which the Spirit is admonishing you to make this place your church home or be a part of this body of faith. I want you to know that we would love to have you. All you have to do is reach out to us via the website. We'll make sure that we respond back unto you and that we give you, extend unto you the rights and privileges of this church, that you may be a full-fledged member here at the Great New Bethel Missionary Baptist Church. We pray this prayer that if there is someone in which the Spirit was moving upon your heart and your mind and urging you to accept Christ as your personal Savior, and for whatever reason you opted not to do so, it's our prayer that the Holy Spirit will continue to weigh heavily upon your mind and your heart until you come to the knowledge and fruition of accepting him as your personal Lord and Savior. And if there is one in which the Spirit was admonishing you to make this place your church home, and for whatever reason you opted not to do so, we pray that the Spirit will continue to keep you under watch care until you're able to unite with the body of faith where you may grow.
in his grace. Amen. September the 7th, 2020 is our Labor Day. So we make sure that we want you guys to take the time out and thank everybody, those in the workforce, as we celebrate Labor Day. Also, on Sunday, September 2020, at 10 a.m. is our Women's Annual Day. Yes, on September 20th, 2020, we will be celebrating our Women's Annual Day. The guest speaker is none other than Reverend Jerry Walker, so we ask that you guys tune in for our celebration. Also, I have one more thing to add. Far as our giving opportunities is concerned, there are two ways that you can give your contributions to the church. One is here in person at Greater New Bethel. You can pull up in your car, and our deacons and our officers will be outside at 8:30 a.m. You can give your tithes and your offering in person. Secondly, you can give online at PushPay. We have set up a PushPay platform to where you can give via online. All you have to do is type in pushpay.com/g/Greater New Bethel Baptist and you will be set up. Last but not least, I have a card to read. A special thank you to the Greater New Bethel family. My mother lived a long, happy life, and I'm going to miss her so much. My memories of fun times with her, I will always cherish in my heart. Thank you for the beautiful plan. What you did was so thoughtful and so appreciated. None love other than Tim Abernathy. Thank you for the card. And if there's not anything else, Pastor Bell will return unto you. This is your brother, Miles Bell. Thank you for listening to our morning announcements.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Miles, for sharing with us our morning announcements. And as Sister Lowe would always say, now that you've heard our announcements, please govern yourselves accordingly. We also want to make sure that we're in continued prayer for those members who were sick and shut in even prior to a COVID condition, and also to our bereaved families. Specifically this week, we're in prayer for the Lamb family. Brother Roderick Lamb lost his aunt and mother figure, Sister Brenda Roberts. So let's be in prayer for the Lamb and the Roberts family. Also, once again, let's continue to practice our social distance measures by wearing our masks and observing the proper amount of distance from each other, and just be extra cautious, especially regarding our seasoned saints and those that have pre-existing conditions. Once again, we thank you for joining and worshiping with us this morning, and always remember that God loves you, and so do I.
I feel the love of the Savior in this place. Place, and it is faith. this way.